great pleasure to have a chance to talk to John Eliot Gardiner, whose work I've long admired. John, when and where were you born?
I was born in Fontmell Magnet in North Dorset in 1943, in a family that was quite eccentric, really, because my mother was brought up as a Quaker. My father, who had a very, very strange ethnic background, his mother was Swedish Finnish on one side and Austrian Hungarian Jewish on the other. And their interests were very wide-ranging. In my mother's case, it included painting, drama, music. In my father's case, it embraced what we'd now call sustainability, and he was an eco-warrior in many, many ways. He was a pioneering organic farmer, but even that's much too simplistic a description, because he really did pioneer the interface between silviculture and agriculture, how trees can raise the water table and provide protection to livestock in an agricultural situation. And he was very conscious of the of geography and of landfall and of how easy it is for man to manipulate it in a violent or a unsympathetic way. And he was very prescient in that way, and curiously prescient in the sense that many of the ideas that he was formulating as a young man and as a founder member of the Soil Association after the Second World War have come to really to become common currency now, in the sense that he foresaw the shortage of fossil fuels and our dependence on them being far too great, and that he really tried very hard to push the ideas of sustainable agriculture and silviculture onto his neighbours and to the farming community itself, and with very mixed results. He was perceived as a very oddball. And the other thing about him, which I admired but is much misunderstood, is that he was born in 1901, and he, having gone to a conventional prep school and then to rugby, which he loathed, he ran away to Beedale's because he was in love with a girl there. And then he came up here, he went to St. John's. And after the First World War was over, he went and worked in the Southern Tyrol to help rebuild villages that had been destroyed during the First World War. And his great argument was that the Peace Treaty of Versailles had set Europe back a huge amount, and therein lay the seeds of future problems, particularly for Germany. And his particular solution was to try and forge alliances between the youth of Britain and the youth of Germany and the youth of the Baltic states and Scandinavia. And his own way of doing it was through the things that were closest to his heart, which was a cappella polyphony, singing and dancing, Morris dancing, sword dancing, and so on, mixed also with this eco-warrior side of him. And he did forge all sorts of very productive relationships, and he wrote a book called North Sea and Baltic, which again is very prescient. It sort of anticipated quite a few of the problems that were going to arise when nationalism started to take hold, particularly in Germany in the late 20s and 30s. And he maintained his friendship with a lot of German contemporaries of his who resisted being swallowed up into the Hitler Jugend of the day, but it got him into trouble with MI5, and it's got him into trouble with later historians who see him as a Nazi sympathizer, which he wasn't in the slightest. But it meant that I was growing up in a household that had quite strong European connections through my mother's side with Italy and France, where she'd studied in her late teens, and through my father with Austria and Germany and the Baltic States and Holland. So there was lots and lots of visitors going on. And then it became even more exotic because my father was involved with a tea estate in Nyasaland, and he organized a young farmers exchange with between Dorset and Nyasaland. And so there were these splendid African farmers visiting us in my early childhood.
Fascinating. What did your father do? Was he a farmer? Or?
Yeah, he was a farmer and a forester. I think he would have put forestry ahead of farming, but he was better known as an organic farmer. He became a very dependent on and associated with his uncle. His uncle was Henry Balfour Gardiner, who was a composer. A composer who belonged to the so-called Frankfurt Gang. And the Frankfurt Gang were English composers born in the 1870s who went to Frankfurt to study with Ivan Knorr, who was a celebrated teacher of Russian German extraction, along with Percy Grainger, Cyril Scott, Roger Quilter, and not Gustav Holst. Let me just try that again, sorry. The Frankfurt Gang was composed of Balfour Gardiner, Percy Grainger, Roger Quilter, Ian Scott, Cyril Scott, and I think one or two others, I can't remember. Mm-hmm. And he was very much under the influence of the Russian, German, the Wagnerian school of the late 19th century, early 20th century, which then was kicked into touch during the First World War. And after the First World War, he found that his musical sympathies were so foreign to the new second Viennese school, Schoenberg, Berg, Webern, that he gave up composing suddenly altogether and burnt a lot of his manuscripts and took up afforestation. And he inveigled my father, who was at a slight loose end there in 1924 or 5, to start to rehabilitate a little corner of North Dorset on the edge of Cranbourne Chase. And together they started this afforestation project, which it was about 2,000 acres, and they planted between 3.5 and 4 million trees between 1927 and 1951, when Balfour died. It was an extraordinary activity, and they employed a lot of local labour, but also unemployed miners from North Yorkshire and from Durham who came on a temporary basis, and in very unprepossessing conditions managed to establish a mixture of deciduous and non-deciduous afforestation, which I'm fortunate enough to be the custodian of today.
I was wondering if it's still there.
It is. It's had quite a checkered family history, but I'm intensely proud and also fearful, in a way, as custodian of it, to make sure that in a time when there's so many new diseases affecting trees that are coming through our imports of foreign timber, that I hand it on to my children and grandchildren in the way that my father and my great uncle were able to pass it on to me. Because you have to, with forestry, far more than farming, you have to think one or two generations ahead, particularly in the British climate, where the growth of trees is particularly slow, and the soils are so incredibly thin where we're farming and growing trees in North Dorset.
Your name, Eliot Gardiner, it's not hyphenated, but it's...
No, my first name is. I'm John Eliot. It's because on my mother's side, it's not hyphenated, but there were many John Eliot Howards, John Eliot Hodgkins. And that's another piece of curious serendipity, that my mother, who was born Maribella Hodgkin, this Quaker family, born in Reading, she discovered when she married my father in 1931... that when they came to Dorset and they started this estate together, that her previous ancestors, her ancestors, had actually lived in the village of Ashmore. Mm. And on the boundary stones, there is J-E-H, which is John Eliot Howard. Completely by serendipity that my name is John Eliot and her ancestors came from the same place.
She's not a relative of Dorothy Hodgkin?
Yes, cousin of Dorothy Hodgkin.
Oh, the Nobel Prize winner.
Absolutely.
Did you know your grandparents at all? Were any of them influential on you?
Yes. My maternal grandfather was a Quaker and a businessman in Reading, but I didn't know him well. He was charming. Mm. His wife was a very eccentric lady called Florence, or Flosco she was known as, and she was the 14th child of the 14th child and was a red-haired Irish lady. I imagine she'd been brought up a Catholic, so that was quite a strong cocktail of influences between the Quaker and the Catholic. I'm not sure of that, but I think that's so. And the Hodgkins, there were two of them. There was my mother, Maribella, and her elder brother, Eliot Hodgkin, who worked for ICI. And Eliot's son, my first cousin, is Howard Hodgkin, the painter. Mm. A wonderful, marvellous man and wonderful painter. On my father's side, my grandfather was Sir Alan Gardiner, who was an Egyptologist and who was part of Carnarvon and Carter's expedition to Tutankhamun in the 20s. And he was the grammarian and the one who was the code breaker of the entrance into Tutankhamun's tomb. And he lived in Iffley in Oxford. And his wife, Hedy, was this curious lady who was Swedish-Finnish on one side and Austro-Hungarian Jewish on the other. And her father, a man called Max von Rosen, was an actor and a diplomat, but he also was a violinist who played in the Vienna Philharmonic. And at one point, well, the first time I conducted the Vienna Philharmonic, which was in the early 90s, I discovered almost sort of serendipitous. My German was quite distinctly Viennese in its inflection and dialect, and that unconsciously I was picking up some of the stuff that I must have heard my grandmother speaking that accent and so on. And my father spoke with a slight Viennese accent too, his German inflected.
Lovely. Well, Dorset Days, which is title of a book I wrote. Can you tell me something about your childhood in this, what sounds like a lovely wooded North Dorset garden?
It was idyllic. It was really wonderful. I was incredibly privileged because even though my parents weren't at all wealthy, they lived in an old mill house with a garden and springs flowing into a lake. And my mother spent a lot of her energies in creating a very beautiful garden, which had a wonderful mixture of the wild and the domesticated. I mean, there were herbaceous borders, but there were also lots of shrubs and wonderful trees. And as children, it was a paradise to grow up there and to experience the sort of mysterious corners of the garden. And thanks to her, also, one got a different type of experience of from the conventional education that one might have had, because she was very heavily into mime and into drama and into dramatizing Icelandic sagas, Tanglewood tales, Greek myths of one sort or another as well, and doing it with the local school children. And she would have us make our own props and improvise our own dialogue, and the plays or the masks that she put on would embrace the whole garden and would require the audience to shift places all through the gardens. And it had a kind of sylvan charm and magic to it. And even though I went to the local school, my mother taught me through the PNEU system. Mm. which was marvellous because there was always music going on in the house. And my parents sang, not particularly well. Well, my mother sang extremely well. She had a trained voice. My father was lustily singing on his tractor or on his horse. But there was always there were always musicians around. And all through the war years, my parents and a couple of others would sing on a Sunday. They'd sing the Bird four-part mass to keep up their spirits during the war years. And they would mark the passage of the seasons with either plays, or it could be a nativity play, or later on a resurrection play, or these much more secular pagan things that went on in the garden. My mother was, I would say, conventionally Christian as a member of the Church of England, even though she been brought up as a Quaker. My father was much more of a sort of pantheist, and he was a strong follower of D.H. Lawrence, and there was a bit of Rudolf Steiner in the background as well. So there's quite a sort of strong mixture and cocktail of different impulses and influences. But the main thing for me was the way that music, and I suppose to some extent drama, were rooted in the environment, in the soil, in the cycle of the seasons. It made a huge impact on me as a little boy. And it never occurred to me that there was anything unusual about that until really trauma kicked in, and they sent me away to a prep school, a very conventional prep school called Pinewood near Shrivenham in Berkshire, which I loathed, and where my contemporaries weren't into the same thing at all, and I couldn't understand how strange that they didn't have music or drama or painting. It was mostly a conventional military school, so they were the sons of colonels and majors and privates. It was very strange.
You went to the wrong school.
I'm sure I went to completely the wrong school. I would have been much happier staying in Dorset, actually, in Fontwell Magnon, going to the village school.
Or to the Dragon, which I went to, which was very musical and artistic.
Well, that would have been fun.
Mm-hmm. Three writers who swirled around my childhood and Dorset. I wonder whether any of them was important to you. One was Kipling, Puck of Pook's Hill in particular.
Indeed.
Enchantment, magic, and those.
Absolutely. My uncle Eliot, who was also my godfather, he gave me on every single birthday another Kipling volume, and I still treasure them. And Puck of Pook's Hill is my very, very favourite.
Second was Llewellyn Powys. Have you ever?
No, it's a name to me.
Love and Death, which is set in Somerset, I think, but it's an elegy to the beauty of that landscape. I'll tell you more about him later.
Yeah.
He was the brother of John Cowper Powys, who is
yes,
famous.
Of course.
Llewellyn Powys. And the third, of course, was Thomas Hardy.
Indeed.
Who was writing around those themes.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I would even speculate that Tess of the D'Urbervilles was raped in our woods. I mean, you know, on the edge of Cranbourne Chase. Mm. And Hardy was a big influence, but the one that you've omitted to say is William Barnes.
Mm.
William Barnes is a great Dorset poet.
Mm.
And a tremendous figure in my childhood, because the farm workers who I grew up with, as it were, well, learning to drive a tractor, learning to drive cart horses and so on, and learning about sheep and shepherding, they could all recite Barnes' poems off the cuff wonderfully. You know, I be shepherd of the farm, we tinkling bells and sheep's dogs bjerk, and with me crook a thirt, me arm, me ride a roll below the lurk. I know all those poems quite by heart. And yes, Kipling, Hardy, and Barnes would be the ones for me.
Mm. What about Just William?
Yes, less attractive.
And Arthur Ransome and.
Arthur Ransome, certainly, but I suppose I was introduced quite early on to the sort of ecological gurus that my father knew, H.J. Massingham,
mm-hmm.
Arthur Bryant, who wrote Our Island Story, he was a visitor, wasn't sure about his politics, mind you,
mm-hmm.
but Adrian Bell was a great friend of my father's, who's the father of What's he called? Who always wears a white suit, and he was a member of King's. He was an undergraduate with me. He became an MP.
Yes, yes.
Martin Bell.
Martin Bell.
Yes, father of Martin Bell.
Mm.
And Thea Bell, who's a wonderful translator too.
Mm. Apart from all this acting and music, were there any other hobbies you had in those days? Did you collect anything or fish or?
I was. I had my own gang in the village, and we got up to all sorts of mischief, and it was terrific. And that was the thing that wrenched my heart when I was sent away to my prep school, because I grew up almost bilingual, and I spoke proper Dorset, and spoke proper at home, as it were.
Mm.
And I loved that contrast. And so the farm and the activities of the farm, which I was very much involved in, both at the dairy and in harvest and with the cart horses and with learning to drive a tractor. That was my main hobby, really, and getting into mischief. And music and dancing with the other two, and painting, because my mother was a good painter and she encouraged me to paint. And I even got a art scholarship, not a music scholarship, from my prep school to Branston, which was my next school.
Probably not worth saying much about your prep school, apart from the fact that
it was horrendous. It was a hotbed of all sorts of nasty forms of pederasty. It was extremely snobbish.
Bullying.
It was a lot of bullying, and a sort of disdain from some of the staff towards the children. There were, of course, exceptions. There were one or two really good teachers, good art teacher, good music teacher, but. Branston was a different thing altogether. Branston had the virtue of being not at all snobbish, of being a very artistic. There were a lot of film cineasts' children who were there, and artists. And even though I got in on an art scholarship to Branston, I felt actually a bit out of sync, because the really good painters at Branston were all abstract painters, and I was very much into portrait painting and still lifes and landscapes and that sort of thing, so that wasn't my thing, and I gravitated then towards music. But I wasn't particularly well taught musically at Branston. It was quite pedestrian, the teaching. I had a very good violin teacher, Peter Chamberlain, but the thing that really grabbed my interest at Branston was history. I had the most inspirational history teacher, John Royds, who later became headmaster of Uppingham, and I'm sure it was thanks to him that I got a scholarship here to King's as a historian, not at all as a musician. I mean, it is so crucial that you meet an inspirational teacher at that time when you're 15, 16, 17. You never forget the lessons that you had and the directions that, you know, fanned open the possibilities that came from an inspirational teacher.
Indeed. What about other things at school? Did you do politics or...?
Yes, I did. I had an awful accident when I was in the 6 months... the holidays between my leaving Pinewood and arriving at Branston, so I was 13... I fell 45 feet off the top of a thatched roof at home. Our house was being rethatched, and I'd made a corn dolly out of straw and went up the ladder, and the ladder slipped, and I slid all the way down the thatched roof and fell then onto flagstones. And I spent the next 6 weeks in hospital, and I was told I would never run or walk properly again. In fact, I had a wonderful orthopedic surgeon that got me going, but it meant that my passion for football and rugby and cricket were somewhat compromised, and I was a sprinter too at school, and so I took up rowing at Branston and rowed in the first state, and also rowed in first state here at King's. But it wasn't my favourite sport. My favourite sport would have been rugby and cricket.
But you couldn't really do those.
Well, I wasn't fast enough anymore.
Yeah. You don't have to be very fast in cricket, but especially
scampering between the... Well, I was a fast bowler. This is the thing.
Oh,
I never. I was never a very good spin bowler, so that didn't work.
Hmm. And what about societies and political societies in the world?
Yes, very definitely. Debating societies and drama. We had the headmaster of Branston was an amazing man called Thor Code, and he. I was fortunate enough to act in several plays under him, including the T.S. Eliot Murder in the Cathedral. I was one of the knights in that. And also I did some of the girls, when I was early on at Branston, in King Lear, I think I did Regan or Goneril, I can't remember which, under his tuition, and he was inspirational, wonderful man. And it was, Branston was different from many public schools at the time because it was semi-co-educational. It wasn't like Beedale's or Dartington, but under the Kurt Hahn system, it was much more liberal, and there was Cranbourne Chase School, which was run in parallel to Branston, and there was the opportunity to make music and do drama with the sister school, and that was a jolly good thing. And the other good thing from my point of view was that it was only 8 miles away from home, so I could get back to the farm, which was crucially important to me.
You were boarding, though.
I was boarding,
Did you do any conducting that stage or not?
Yes, I did. I did a little bit. When I was about 15, I started. I still had no idea which direction my life was going to go. That took several years to determine. But there were sort of competing interests, and they were, I suppose, farming and the environment, music of one sort or another. I sang a great deal, both as a treble and when my voice broke, as a tenor. Conducting, but probably after singing at that stage, playing the violin and playing the viola later on. And I applied for the National Youth Orchestra of Great Britain and only got in at the second attempt, but I couldn't take up my place in NYO because the telegram telling me that I'd been accepted and would I please come to Russia was delivered to me by a Bedouin on a camel out of his camel bags 4 months later than after the tour had taken place, because I was working at Petra in the Jordan Valley at the time. So there was that, and then increasingly I suppose it was oriental things, I mean particularly Middle Eastern studies, because I had a godfather, Christopher Scaife, who was a wonderful man. He was a friend of Dady Ryland's here. And in fact I got the two of them together when I was running KCMS to do the Shakespeare and music reading, but I'm getting ahead of myself. He was professor of English literature at the American University in Beirut, and my parents took me out there when I was very little, and in my gap year when I left Branston I went to Beirut and got a series of jobs in the Middle East, and he was a big influence on me and introduced me to a number of different Arabists, and it was through him that I met Kim Philby, who was just about to turn coat and go to Russia. I met Edward Said, who became a great friend. I met Katie Antonius, who was the widow of George Antonius, the great Arabist there. I learned to speak Arabic there. I had three jobs in a short period of time. One was working in a Lutheran, World Council of Churches refugee camp outside Bethlehem, where we were building a Lutheran school, a wing of a Lutheran school. That was a strange experience. And the second one was 6 weeks spent in Petra, or just outside Petra, where I went to work for an archaeologist called Diana Kirkbride. And the third experience, which was in a way was the most enriching, was working for UNRWA, United Nations Relief and Works Agency for the Palestinian Refugees. I worked in Beirut, but I was given an assignment to make a film script, to write a film script on refugee conditions, and then went all through Jericho, Gaza, Bethlehem and so on. And I learned a huge amount about the plight of the Palestinian refugees and the tensions. We're talking 1961. And John Saltmarsh, who became one of my history teachers here at King's. I met him in Beirut. He was out there looking at Crusader castles.
Mm.
And I remember a very strange conversation with him on my return. This was in my second year at King's, because I was trying to organize a tour then of the Oxford and Cambridge singers to Lebanon, Jordan, and Syria. And there was one of those regular border incidents between Jordan and Syria, and the frontier was shut. And I had to get back for the beginning of term here at King's. So I showed my old United Nations pass, which I'd had the year before, but it had expired, and they waved me through. What I didn't realize is that by the time I got to Damascus, they'd rung my old boss, and she had said, no, he doesn't work for us anymore. So I was cast into jail for, I think, two nights, maybe been three nights, into a cell which I shared with an existentialist Frenchman who was a journalist from Le Monde. And I still don't know to this day why I was let out and how I was let out, but I did get out, and I came back to King's a week late and knocked on the door of John Saltmarsh and said, I saw you in Beirut a fortnight ago, I'm awfully sorry, but I've been in prison. He said, oh, don't worry, dear boy, don't worry, no problem.
Lovely. Well, we've almost got on to university, but one thing that often happens at around 15, 16 is that one starts questioning the fundamentals of one's belief system. Sometimes coincides with having to decide whether to be confirmed into the Christian church, and sometimes with the loss of faith or a new kind of faith. Did that happen to you? Or?
It did, to some extent. I was a confirmed member of the Anglican Church, and I was confirmed when I was 14. But it was, my religious upbringing was always qualified by, I suppose, my parents' humanism and the wider context that they would establish for religious belief. It was not straight down the middle at all, and I think that music has always been incredibly linked in my mind with religious belief. And even when in my 20s and 30s and progressively I lost my conventional Christian beliefs, I refound them in the moment of making music. I don't for a moment think that you need to be a Christian in order to understand or to appreciate the music of Bach or any other religious composer, but I think it helps if you can understand the theology of it. And I think if you allow yourself to penetrate the membrane, which can be sometimes very off-putting, of the religious, of the theological kind of package that surrounds the music, and you get to the heart of it, you can find that there is a core of human belief systems that transcend the parochial and the denominational side of religion. I think that's been a big part of my life, to find that in rejecting standard belief, I can re-find it or re-assess it or re-connect with it through music. And I think also that studying other religions, and I mean, in my third year here at King's, I was reading Arabic, and I studied the Quran very, very closely. That also provides a different context for one's past or current Christian beliefs, obviously in a wider, more ecumenical context.
Thank you. Well, we may come back to that. So let's come to King's College, Cambridge, 1962, is it?
61. I took the exam, yes. I mean, I remember in the Chetwynd room on a November, very cold November day, arriving and with a great ream of foolscap blank paper, and John Saltmarsh walking in and writing one word on the board, and he wrote circuses and then walked out. And 4 hours later, one had had one stab at writing about circuses, and then a very penetrating interview with John Raven, who was a senior tutor, and John Broadbent, which I felt was wonderful. I mean, the reason I applied for King's was again thanks to my father, because he knew, he was a close friend of Dady Rylands, and he said, Dady said, you have to come to King's, and anyway, if he's musical, he'll find a home for himself at King's. Well, I won a minor history scholarship to King's, but I didn't apply for, and I didn't particularly want to become a choral scholar. And as soon as I arrived here, I found that I was really out of step with the musical traditions of the college, as they were then exemplified by David Wilcox, and this is after Boris Ord's era, because it clashed really very noisily with my own musical upbringing, which had not been associated with the liturgy, it had not been associated with a cathedral, and certainly not one as with such a distinctive acoustic and distinctive sound world as that of King's. So that the music that I knew as a child and was still passionately in love with, English music of Tallis and Bird, but also of Purcell, Schütz, the German 17th century composer, Bach, Italian music, Palestrina, but also Monteverdi, insofar as that it was performed at all in the chapel, the foreign music, and of course the English music was performed and Palestrina was performed, it was done in a homogeneous, all-purpose style, which I felt, in a way, trivialized the music and put it into a sort of in heavy crystals, or in a rather saccharine style of singing, and it to me it lacked sort of guts and fire and a visceral contact with the composers. So I felt very out of place, and even though I remember at my freshest concert that I had the temerity, because I loved singing, I adored singing, so I sang some Schubert and Mahler songs there, and the King's Chorus Scholars of the day thought this was very odd, A, that I a non-chorus scholar was singing, and B, that I was singing Schubert and Mahler. Why wasn't I doing Roger Quilter and Ivor Gurney and the English pastoral style, which was what they were keen on. And having missed out on playing in the National Youth Orchestra, I didn't know the instrumentalists of the day. I got to learn them, and Cambridge was then curiously, perhaps it always has been, full of coteries, of little clans of sympathies, musical sympathies and other sympathies. So that, I mean, if on the one hand there were the choral scholars, the King's Choral Scholars, who were in deep competition with the Jonians and John's College choral scholars, there was the NYO lot, the National Youth Orchestra lot, who were brilliant musicians, they were fantastically talented musicians. I mean, in my contemporaries, there was Chris Van Kampen, a wonderful cellist. There was Andrew Davis, who became a great pal of mine as a distinguished conductor. Christopher Seaman, very fine conductor. And then there were the early music lot, who were, there weren't many at King's, they were mostly at Pembroke. There was Christopher Hogwood and David Munro, who, you know, it was all beards and sandals and recorders and raffia shoes. Again, a little clique on its own who met at the music club. I didn't know where to fit in at all. I didn't fit in. With individual musicians, I struck up an alliance, and I played in the Comes 2 Orchestra, led it actually for a while, and it took me a while to get into the Comes 1 Orchestra.
Were you playing?
I was playing the violin. I later went on to the viola because my arms are too long for a violin. I felt cramped on the violin. And I started with Andrew, we started the Cambridge University String Players and formed our own little ensemble, which was quite adventurous and very talented string players from all around the university. But the thing that was sort of agitating inside me, and I had to find a release for it somehow or other, was this impulse to become, to dedicate my life to music. And it was in fierce competition with all these other interests that I had. I mean, as a historian, I was enormously stimulated by the, well, by the subject matter, but also by the teaching and the varied teaching that I had here in the college. I mean, you couldn't choose four more radically different history dons than Christopher Morris, with his very old school approach towards the Tudors.
In this room.
In this very room, sitting right here. John Saltmarsh, with his wonderful sort of antiquarianism and his passionate love of the college and of the chapel and of its architecture. And he was such a great and enthusiast for all things King's, and marvellous, and would deliver these magnificent sort of sermon-like disquisitions on Gothic architecture. Jasper Rose, who was a real eccentric, and Arthur Hibbert, who I was much closest to and was very, very fond indeed of. And they each had varying styles of teaching and of running tutorials, and also their approach to history was so different. I mean, just to give you an example, with Christopher Morris, you would come in with your lecture, your essay, and he would read it silently, puffing on his pipe, and you think, oh God, what is he thinking about this? And he would make no comment until the end. With John Saltmarsh, you had to hand it in the day before, and he would then give this sort of marvellously elegant, poetic discourse on how you got it wrong and how really it should have been formulated in this way. With Arthur, you read it out to him, and he would chortle away in the background, or sniff, or harumph one way or another, but it always led to the most extraordinarily broad-ranging conversation thereafter. And in a way, the most intimidating was Jasper, because he would read your essay out loud to you, getting the inflection wrong, getting the punctuation wrong. So you sat there thinking, for heaven's sake, that's not what I meant at all, you have read it wrong. But it was hugely stimulating, and also the different history dons that I met, lecturers. One of my special subjects, I had two special subjects, one of them was the Scottish Enlightenment, and there was Duncan Forbes, brilliant lecturer at Clare. And the other thing which became really more and more dominant in my thinking in my time at King's was the whole Western mythology about the Middle East. I read a paper to the Ten Club. I was a member of the Ten Club, called Western Myths About the Arab World. And that had grown out of, you know, years and years of visiting the Middle East and then spending my gap year there, or gap 6 months as it was, and through learning colloquial Arabic and then trying to learn classical Arabic here in my third year, and feeling in my bones that there was something desperately wrong in both in the politics that were perpetrated ever since the Sykes-Picot agreement and the Balfour Declaration in the course of the First World War, and in the Suez Crisis of 56, in our Western approach towards the Muslim and the Christian Arab world, and how it had its antecedents in the Crusades and in that sweet sour relationship that the West has had with the Middle East. On the one hand, seeing it as a glamorous Oriental paradise of a never a sort of la la land, never never land, and on the other hand, taking this high ground of disdain towards the Arabs as somehow being no better than souk merchants, as it were. And it's of course, all comes to a head in Said's book on Orientalism, and it troubled me a great deal. And I really was very tempted in my time at King's to say, well, when I've done here, I would like to go and research that, and I'm even pursue that in a political environment. But other things took precedence, and I suppose this is the time to pay tribute to Edmund Leach, because even though he was a social anthropologist and he wasn't a historian, he was my director of studies. Mm. And he became a close friend, he and Celia, his wife, and I used to visit their house frequently. And Edmund loved music, and as did Celia. Edmund took me aside and said, look, it's really time you made up your mind. You know, which direction are you going to be? I mean, he did it with this wonderful smile, almost laughing at the time. He was a great leg puller, but also deeply sympathetic. And he said, look, you know, you could be a historian, I'm sure, and in this flirtation with the Arab world, it'll probably burn itself out, but it might be worth pursuing. And then you have this background in farming and silviculture, and you're very keen on that. Edmund was extraordinarily compassionate, but also he wouldn't let me get away with just giving him inadequate answers. He said, look, you really have to focus on this. You know, there are several possibilities that you could pursue, but time to really focus and concentrate. And we went through the various options. And I said, well, look, Edmund, I really need to test myself to see whether I really have it in me to be a musician or not. And I, you know, I'm outside the conventional system. I'm not a pianist. I'm not an organist. I don't sing in the college chapel choir, but I do have an enormous residual from childhood love of music. And I think that it's going to consume me very soon. And I need to put myself to the test to see if I can really, you know, cut the mustard. And he said, well, you better take a year off and find out whether you're going to be a musician. How are you going to do that? Do you want to leave? Do you want to go to the Royal College of Music? And I said, no. He said, do you want to switch to the music faculty? And I said, heavens above, no. I felt the music faculty was very, very, or the curriculum was very, very foreign to what I was wanting to do at the time. And I said, I think what I really need to do is to set myself a particular assignment with a work that has huge challenges to it, and to see if I can actually bring it off. And that's when I suggested to him that I should perform the Monteverdi Vespers, which was then a work that had scarcely ever been performed in Cambridge. I think Boris Auden may have done it once, but here in King's, but it was not at all mainstream. It was everything that the music tradition of King's was not. In other words, it was Italian, it was multicolored, it was very passionate music making that's required to bring it off. And it was right outside the comfort zone of most of the musicians who were available of my generation. So I set about setting up that performance, and I was currently secretary of KCMS, the King's College Music Society, and I went to speak to David Wilcox about it, and he was very interested and sympathetic to the idea, and said, well, yes, of course you should do it in the chapel, and you've got to put together a choir and an orchestra, and good luck to you, and but we don't have any money, so how are you going to do it? So I had to set about by applying to different trusts to raise the money for it, including the Vaughan Williams Trust, who gave us, I think, £250, which was quite a lot. And I then went to see Thurston Dart, who was then professor of music here, and he was absolutely wonderful. He said, he didn't say, but, you know, what on earth are you doing? You're not even reading music. He knew a bit about me, I think, already, and he said, no, it's quite clear what you should do. You have to make your own edition. We've got on microfilm all the part books that are in the Pendlebury Library. Go off, transcribe it, make edition. I'll have a look at it for you, and off you go. So I was in an incredibly privileged position in the sense of having some encouragement, but at that stage, very little skill and very little expertise. And then I thought, well, I've got to somehow form a choir to do this incredibly challenging, demanding music. And I spoke to one or two of the choral scholars and John's and Trinity and so on. And I even auditioned some of them. I had the, you know, the chutzpah and the temerity and of youth to do that. And they'd never heard of Monteverdi's Vespers. I mean, some of them had sung a few madrigals under Raymond Leppard in a punt on the Cam, but a piece of these dimensions was totally outside their ken. And so we started rehearsing, and I had quite a lot of rehearsal. And I remember rehearsing in King's Hall and Thurston Dart, bless his heart, coming and sitting in the back. And when we mispronounced the Latin, laudate, and it came out laudate, he said, "There is no R in laudate, Mr. Gardiner," and sort of G'd us along. And I was trying to get this group of, this heterogeneous bunch of choral scholars and amateurs, musicians in Cambridge, and including sopranos and altos from the women's colleges, and some came down especially from the Royal College of Music, to sing in a very extravagantly extrovert, passionate way, with lots of different vowel color contrasts, so that the drama and the theatricality of the music would come through, and that the incredible imagination of Monteverdi's mind, his musical mind, would impinge on our performance. And I had, on the one hand, the chapel against us, in the sense that it's a wonderful long Gothic shoebox. It's not a basilica with lots of galleries in it. On the other hand, I had the bonus of the presence of this magnificent tableau by Rubens,
which was at this end, wasn't it?
It was actually on an easel, and
Jaffe,
it was in front of
Jaffe.
Michael Jaffe had bought it for the college, and it had not yet been put in its current position, which personally I think is a mistake, because it's dwarfed by that wonderful stained glass window. But it was on an easel just in front of the rood screen, and it looked magnificent there. And of course it's in honor of the Blessed Virgin, and so Monteverdi Vespers, and Rubens and Monteverdi were contemporaries in Mantua. So I took a great deal of heart and encouragement from the presence of that painting. And sure enough, on the 5th of March 1964, we performed this piece, for good or evil, in the chapel. And it, I'm glad there's no recording of it, because I would have been appalled by the results, but it caused a stir. And it was attended by a lot of very distinguished musicians, including Thurston Dart, including Ray Leppard, including David Wilcox, including George Malcolm, who'd come down from Westminster Cathedral to listen to it. And it got national press, and it was quite exciting. And I suppose it was the epiphany that I was looking for that actually encouraged me to say, okay, that's the way my life is going to go from now onwards. And that really was the moment when I said, okay, I'm now going to study to become a professional musician. So I went on and did the part two of the History Tripos the following year, and then I followed Thurston Dart, who'd left Cambridge to set up a new music faculty at King's College London, and became one of his first postgraduate students. And I had a fascinating year doing musicology, sort of musicological detective work with him, and doing the chore of learning harmony and counterpoint, or beginning to. And after a year with him, he slung me out. He said, "You've got to go abroad now. You're not going to stay here any longer. And you must go to Prague, or you can go to Budapest. That's where you'll learn the most." And I said, "Well, thanks, Bob, but actually I'm going to go to Paris, because I wanted to study with Nadia Boulanger, who was the sort of doyenne of musical teachers of the day. She was 80 at the time, and I won a French government scholarship to study with her in 1967. And I'd met her a couple of times earlier. She'd come to teach at the Branston Summer School long before I went to the school, but this was when I was 6 or 7 years old. And my parents had taken me along, and I heard her lecture, and that was my first experience of hearing Monteverdi. So she really implanted the seed of Monteverdi in my musical brain, as it were. And then I then heard her again when she came over to the Royal College of Music when I was 15 or 16 and heard a lecture on Schubert and Brahms and was completely enchanted. And when I went to study with her in 67, and I had 2 years with her, it was like being back at kindergarten, because she, and it was such a shock to me after the system of the liberal arts education I'd had at King's, because this was the French system, and it was she took no prisoners at all. It was a very, very rigorous system. And one was enormously in awe of this lady. Her pupils were nearly all American or British. She hardly had any French pupils. As I say, she was 80 at the time, and she was semi-blind, but this is a woman who taught, who'd been a pupil of Fauré, who had taught Aaron Copland, Lenny Bernstein, Eliot Carter, Virgil Thompson, all the American composers of the day, and Lennox Barkley, and who was a great friend of Stravinsky's, and whose musical ear was sharper and more acute and more discerning than any other musician I'd ever come across. That's still the case today. I think only Pierre Boulez approaches her in his ability to hear wrong notes and to dissect harmonies. And she put me back right to square one, and she would mock me really cruelly, but my dear, really, this is no good at all. You are doing an exercise now which I could do when I was 5 years old. It was tough going, but it was what I needed. It really was, because I had to do harmony, but not the way harmony is taught here or in the conservatoires in Britain, keyboard harmony as they call it. This was writing your harmony exercises on four different staves, four different clefs, and in effect you were writing counterpoint, because what she was interested in was not just the vertical alignment of the music, that the chord progressions, but actually the intersection of the lines, the weaving in, and how beautiful and honed and distinctive you could make those lines. So it was an extraordinarily elaborate process that required a very discerning, self-critical ear to get it right. And it wasn't easy, because she insisted on teaching all her American and British pupils in English, and her English was eccentric. And then you wrote your harmony exercise and brought it to her, and very often she would write B with a big capital B, and I thought, well, because she speaks English to me, that must be for bad. And it took me about 3 months to discover it was for bon, for good. Meanwhile, I'd had to sort of redo the exercise, and she obliged one to do it with a little kind of insert that you had to paste on with sellotape or scotch tape over the top, over your correction, but on a hinge so you can see what your error had been the last time. And my harmony books became like sort of archaeological digs with all sorts of undulations of corrections and super corrections, often unnecessary because I'd misread the B for bon as B for bad. But that was the least of my worries. I mean, the thing for me was that I was learning to catch up, because I was a late starter. I was an intuitive, instinctive musician. I had had some experience of conducting. I'd had this wonderful opportunity of doing the Monteverdi Vespers here. I'd taken a choir to the Middle East and performed in Syria and in Jordan and in Lebanon. I had started the Monteverdi Choir on my move from Cambridge to London in 1966. We'd done our first Wigmore Hall concert. The BBC were already starting to commission me to do programs for them. I became the youngest history in the history of the proms when I did, in 1968, I did the Vespers in the Royal Albert Hall. But meanwhile, I was playing catch up in learning to give some kind of technical underpinning to my music making under her, you know, scrutiny and a beagle eye. I mean, beady eye. She didn't let you off the hook at all, and she'd haul you up in front of the whole class. In the summer months, all of us Boulanger pupils would decamp to Fontainebleau, outside Paris, a grand palace where Hitler had also occupied a couple of the grand rooms during the Second World War. And we were then joined by the creme de la creme of the American conservatoires, like Juilliard School and Eastman School. And it was highly competitive. And above all, to try and get into her solfège class, solfège being the French way of ear training, and of, it's not just tonic solfa, it's something much more sophisticated and also more debilitating, as taught by most French music teachers. But Boulanger taught it brilliantly, and it was a wonderful, all-encompassing way of educating the ear and of training the ear. And but it was regimented and extremely severe, and you were chastised publicly and brought down a peg, and it was a test of your nerve, really, and of your resilience. And this is pretty different from what I was used to in the 4 years I spent as an undergraduate at King's, where there was this wonderful collegiate atmosphere and a convivial atmosphere for the most part, particularly with the tutorial system, to which I've referred already. I mean, to the delightfully kind of egalitarian and compassionate way that a teacher like Arthur Hibbert would share with you, which was wonderful. This was du haut en bas, very much. And it was quite traumatic for me. I mean, she would haul me up in class and get me to do some pretty difficult exercises while the rest of the students would clamor to be allowed to show me how I'd got it wrong. And she said, no, but he must suffer. He has to suffer. And boy, did I suffer. But in a way, it toughened me up, and it was extremely useful training to, which has spared my blushes subsequently when exposed to the harsh daylight of professional music making. Because after 2 years studying with Annie Boulanger, I felt like a sort of hothouse plant. I needed to breathe, and so on. And I, much to her annoyance and chagrin, I applied and got the job as apprentice conductor of the BBC Northern Orchestra in Manchester, which was a very hard-bitten orchestra in those days, heavy drinking, heavy smoking orchestra, brilliant sight readers, but took no prisoners at all. And in my first year there, I would get to conduct the overture of a three-piece concert, not the concerto or the symphony. And if the overture lasted, say, 15 minutes, I would be given 12 minutes rehearsal time only. So the only time I could play through the whole overture was when the red light was on and we were recording, which meant that in your rehearsal you had to be incredibly clear, both with your gestures, but also when you stopped the orchestra to say anything, and which bits you could take on trust that they would manage to do, and which you really needed to focus on if you wanted to have any influence on the outcome. And so that was a different type of test. And I suppose the thing that sustained me in all that was the fact that despite this rigorous training that I'd been receiving, first of all from Thurston Dart in musicology, and then from Nadia Boulanger in harmony and counterpoint and technique, and to some extent conducting technique that I'd received on summer courses from George Hurst, I was putting that into practice with a professional orchestra and later on with other professional orchestras in London and in France. But I had my home base, which was the Monteverdi Choir, which I'd founded here at King's and taken to London, and it had then started to take a life of its own, and it had then become a mixture of professional, young professional singers, such as the King's singers who'd been founder members of my choir, who had to be paid, and very talented amateurs who were willing to give their services. And we were becoming busier and busier. And it brought all the strands of my life together in the sense, or musical strands of my life together, because it enabled me to pursue and to deepen my love of Renaissance and Baroque music, and to explore it with much greater intensity and to a far higher standard than obviously I was used to as a schoolboy or even here at King's. And to become a part of this burgeoning movement of radical reappraisal of early music that was taking wing then in the late 60s and 70s. And it's really, even now, here in 2015, it's looking back on it, it's been an absolute topsy-turvy change in the way that musicians and therefore audiences and listeners have come to terms with music of the past, much more historically attuned, much more historically informed, much more nuanced, according to epoch, but also nationality and the temperament and character of different composers, instead of this sort of general wishy-washy approach when everything is done in the same, basically the same style on the same instruments. And your approach to it as a historian or as a musician now can be in a variety of different ways. Some people will say, well, it's just nostalgia, or it's revisionism, or it's a substitute for the absence of really gripping contemporary music. I don't think it's that at all. I think it's... What's that dripping noise? Oh, it's fine. Oh, it's probably somebody hammering pegs for the marquee in the ground, in the lawn.
That's probably it. Yes.
That's just a little aside. I have to tell you this. Founders Feast, I think it was in 1964. I wasn't a member of the Chetwynd Society, but the Chetwynd Society managed to do something wonderfully dramatic and theatrical. They released the heifers that were grazing on the other bank of the Cam, drove them across the bridge, drove them under the arch of Gibbs Building at the moment when Noel Annan, the provost, and all the fellows were coming out of hall, and the heifers went round the fountain and the founder's statue with their tails in the air, with wonderful excrement flying from in all quarters. It was just, I witnessed it all. It was absolutely great, and I thought Noel Annan dealt with it brilliantly. He just wrote a short note to the secretary of the Chetwynd Society saying that all traces of excrement had to be removed by 5 o'clock the next morning, and it was all done. But it was a great moment. No, back to the point. Some people have criticised the whole of the historically informed period performance.
Tell me what it exactly means. It means okay. Contemporary instruments, or...?
What it means is this. It's... In essence, what the whole movement was a bringing to bear on music of the past a much more historically informed scrutiny of the source material, the instruments that were used at the time of any given composer, the tuning of those instruments, the temperament that were used, different temperaments, musical temperaments, pitch of the pieces concerned, whether they were anything like modern pitch, higher, lower, the numbers of performers, not just on the instruments, but how they performed, the spaces in which they were performing. It was in a sense a labor of antiquarianism, of reconstruction, but it was also, which I think much more interesting, it was a way of testing the pertinence and relevance and currency of music of the past to our contemporary situation. Has it stood the test of time, or is it simply an anachronism. And the conclusions that many of us came to, and they weren't always coordinated, was that the music of the past, if it's performed with that type of scrutiny and type of attention to detail, could provide a far greater currency now than it did 30, 40 years prior to that, where it was done in a slightly condescending fashion. And so it led to a whole rash of different experiments and pioneering groups who would come to radically different conclusions, but it was never less than stimulating. And depending on your personality or your tendencies and your aesthetic tastes, it either became an exercise in antiquarianism, or it became a type of incredibly passionate and engaged reconstructionism of bringing to life something that had lain dormant or shrouded. And the usual analogy that's used is like taking a layer of varnish off a painting, but it's different from that. I mean, the crucial difference between music and drama with the fine arts, with painting and sculpture, is that you can't alter a painting, you can't alter a sculpture, it stays the same, and your reaction to it will be different, but it stays basically the same. But with music, it's one thing to be on the page, but it's another thing to translate it, or to be translated into sounds, and those sounds will vary from one interpreter to another, and one day to another, and depending on all sorts of different circumstances and different impulses. And so it's a continually evolving process. It never stops. So it's not as if you can say, well, you know, the terrain has been gained, now we can move on to something else. It'll be different again tomorrow. And to have been a part of that movement and to have witnessed what it's produced over the last 50 years has been a huge privilege and a wonderful experience, and not always a comfortable one. I mean, as so often, pioneers tend to exaggerate and tend to be so sectarian and so passionate in their espousal of a particular view on something, on music of the past, that they will exaggerate and their results can emerge very mannered. And then there's some duplication, and then there's some antipathy. And it's been a question of really of constant self-criticism and self-appraisal of how one approaches that music of the past and what its relevance might be in our society today, and how it can change people's lives, because it does change people's lives. It can change their belief system. It can be a substitute for belief. It can be a palliative. It can be a means of coming to terms with bereavement, with grief, with all sorts of psychological breakdowns, damaging, ill health, or it can be simply just wonderful entertainment. It can be taken at so many different levels, but it's hugely pertinent, I think, and it means that music making is not just an arcane process that is restricted to an elite group of performers and an elite group of conoscenti who appreciate it, but has the capacity to transcend and to leap over boundaries. I mean, I'll just give you one example. I mean, Bach, whom you know is very dear to my heart, his music was written, the bulk of it, for a very narrow sectarian version of Orthodox Lutheranism at a midpoint in the 18th century. Really sort of the last death throes of Lutheranism, in a sense, because it before it became subsumed in the Enlightenment. He wrote a cantata for every single Sunday in the church year, and maintained his cycles over 2 or 3 years. We don't know quite how many have gone missing, but we've certainly got 200 of them. And they're extraordinarily powerful pieces, lasting anything from 15 to 30 minutes each. And because he wrote them at speed, it's a bit like Charles Dickens writing his novels for monthly installments and then piecing it all together. He didn't have much time to edit or to be self-censoring, so that he lets his guard down in the cantatas much more than he does in the Passions or the B minor Mass or the Christmas Oratorio. And so you get a sense that his own personality is grinning through the fabric of the music, and that he has certain buttons that get pressed, things that irritate him, things that annoy him, or things that are particularly close to his heart. For example, he doesn't pull any punches when it comes to hypocrites or to self-serving Lutherans that he thinks are just there for paying lip service, and he will send down this bombardment of musical bombardment from the gallery of the St. Thomas Church in Leipzig, where I've just come back from now, to the unsuspecting congregation, just as often as he will provide the music of most ineffable peace and consolation to those who are going through awful periods of either disbelief or bereavement. So I'm a passionate advocate, really, of the currency that music making, not music itself, but music making, can have on society at large and on the individual within society. And without distorting it and creating a pretension for it, which I think would be unfortunate, I do believe that it is a force for good and for social cohesion, and for a way of binding a community together, both in the act of music making through singing and through playing, but also in the way that an audience gets drawn into the process, and how, as a musician, as a conductor, somebody who's responsible for igniting getting the spark going, that you can find yourself actually both highly involved in the performance, but also distanced from the performance, where you can almost step aside and observe what's happening and how people are imbibing it or receiving it or digesting it in some way or other. And that's a fascinating process, and it's never lost its force or its charm for me.
That's a lovely description of Bach. And I ask about my favourite composer. When Beethoven was asked who he thought was his greatest predecessor ever, do you know who he chose?
He chose Bach.
No. Handel.
Well, I'm not sure I'd agree with you on that. He did revere Handel. He revered Haydn, but he also revered Bach. And he said, Bach in German means a brook, but to me he's not a brook, he's a ein Meer, he's a sea, he's an ocean.
Well, it's a my attempt to push up Handel failed, but...
No, it doesn't fail at all. I adore Handel.
I noticed you did Acis and Galatea quite early on in your career, and then you've done Handel, a lot of Handel.
I did a lot of Handel, and I was 10 years director of the Handel Festival in Göttingen, and that was a great experience, and I revered to this day Handel enormously. And I don't want to compare him with Bach, because they're on about different things.
Yes.
And it's an extraordinary thing that there were they born within a few miles of each other in the same year. Mm. They never met, despite efforts, certainly on Bach's side, to meet the other. And their careers were so sort of diametrically opposed. Handel was a man of the world, a cosmopolitan. He went to Italy, he went to Ireland, he came to here, lived. Bach always lived within the German lands, and yet both of them were absolutely au fait with all the currents of music making of their day, and would have had fascinating conversations had they met. And both composers have lasted over centuries. You know, they've stood the test of time. And Beethoven, I think, was deeply influenced by both of them.
Mm.
Now, Beethoven, I mean, there's a case of somebody who tangled with politics and got bruised by politics in a way. I mean, you think of him in the early 1800s, totally under the spell of the French Revolution and of Napoleon Bonaparte, and even thinking of moving from Bonn or Vienna to go to Paris and live in back Paris. He never did. And then getting so disillusioned when Napoleon crowned himself emperor, and he thought, you know, this was hubris and terrible disillusionment set in. And then he went through a really, really bad patch at the time of writing Fidelio, where his music became very nationalistic, almost crypto-fascist. There are a couple of pieces of his, one's called Germania and the other's called Die glorreiche Augenblick, which are quite nasty in their sort of very rum-ti-tum, proto-Nazi kind of triviality, really. And then, of course, he reserves the best to the last, and he comes through all that, and you get this absolutely Promethean power of the final quartets, the last quartets, the Missa Solemnis, which to me is his greatest work of all, and the Ninth Symphony. So his political sympathies changed, and he got his fingers and his toes singed and burnt by sympathies of one sort or another.
That leads rather well into Mahler, and not into Mahler, into Wagner. I was very struck by the fact, it's true, I don't know, but in one account of your work, that you won't play Wagner.
It's not that I won't, it's just that I don't have a great sympathy towards the man or his music.
Mm-hmm.
I find him as an individual quite off-putting. Not so much of his personal life or his statements, but in the fact that he seemed to arrogate to himself the right to have composed music that he never composed. That he seemed to think that he had somehow composed the music of Weber, even of Beethoven, even of Schubert and Schumann. His writings about music of the past suggest that it was almost his implication that created it, which of course is preposterous. But more than that, I find Wagner difficult to stomach because of the preponderant influence that he had on music making of his day, to the detriment of other composers, particularly Brahms, and to the long shadow that his music cast right up until, well, you could still argue that it's still present today, but it certainly had a huge impact on music making up to the First World War breaking out. On French composers as varied as Faure and Debussy, on English composers like Elgar, and that it was a kind of harmonic distortion, exaggeration of the classical language of music, which is very powerful and very attractive in its way, but it's tainting to me. My fear, apart from the fact that I don't feel I've got anything to contribute, my fear is that if I conducted a whole Wagner opera, or let alone a Ring cycle, that it would be impossible for me, having done so, to ever take a step back and go back to conducting Handel and Bach and Mozart, or even the great 19th century composers that I adore so much, Beethoven, Schumann, Schubert, Mendelssohn, Brahms. The list is immense, and I would find that might be a contaminating influence. But it's a very subjective judgment, and I know I'm in a minority. And the other thing that gets me about Wagner is also the way that he seems to demand or to imply compliance, and that you should bend the knee to him. That, you know, you can't be lukewarm. You can't be critical. You're either a fully paid up card carrying Wagnerite or you're not, and I don't like being manipulated in that way. Seduced, yes, but not manipulated.
Well, I've got two last questions. One is about how you work yourself. I mean, I often interview writers and historians and academics, and I ask them whether they work with music around them or whether they work and have their best thoughts walking, or but I've never really asked that of a conductor. I mean, can you tell me about the pattern of your work before you're going to give a big performance?
Well, I mean, this is the most banal level. You have to know the score. You have to know the score inside out. And when I say know the score, you need to commit it to memory as much as possible. You need to know its component parts in terms of orchestration, in terms of voicing, in terms of its harmonic structure, its rhythmic structure, and so on. That goes without saying. You need to also establish an empathy with the composer through a pretty good familiarity with the terms and conditions under which it was actually created, how it came into existence, for what audience, in what space, for what occasion, how was the orchestra composed, how was the choir composed, what type of voices it had, what type of preoccupations any composer had at the time of composing it. That, to me, as a historian, as a King's trained historian, is terribly important to establish the context. Then it's a matter really of being very still and very quiet and listening to it and reconstructing it in one's head, in one's inner ear. I mean, a lot of my colleagues as conductors are brilliant keyboard players, and they can whiz through it and do it that way. I can't. I'm not a very skilled, well, I'm a very, very poor keyboard player. So I train myself, and thanks to Nadie Boulanger, to learn a score sitting in a chair, silently reconstructing it in my mind and going back on it, back and back again. And then it comes to the question of rehearsing it, and that's a matter of practicality, because rehearsals are expensive and time-consuming, and an orchestra or a choir's patience is taxed by too much rehearsal or too little rehearsal. If you have too little, then you're asking a heck of a lot of the performers on their sight-reading skill and their attentiveness in the moment of performance. You've got to get that balance right. And as a conductor, a heck of a lot is associated with empathizing with the performer's problems, whether they be technical on a wind instrument or the embouchure or the point of contact between a bow and a string, if you're a string player, or the difficulties of breathing, the opportunities to breathe, the opportunities of expressing yourself through the music, not in a negatistical way, but in a way that's actually serving the music. You have to know what the technical problems are, but also the psychology of the performer. And perhaps the most important thing of all, you have to, or it's best if you can create in the minds of your performing apparatus, the ensembles that you're conducting, the sense that it's actually their interpretation, not yours, or at least that they've got room and flexibility to express themselves, so that it's not like in the bad old days when you have a dictatorial conductor, a despot who says this is how it's going to be and you play like this or you'll be fired, but that there's a consensus. But it's more than just being consensual, it's also a psychological trick of being able to, insofar as you circumstances will allow, to get a singer or an individual player to feel that his or her contribution is absolutely critical to the success of the performance. And that takes a lifetime to, and you know, one still makes mistakes, but that's the goal.
That's a lovely account. The last question is about your family. Were you an only child, or...?
No, I was one of three. I was the youngest of three. Mm. I'm close to my sister, who's four and a half years older than me. She has Alzheimer's, poor thing. And still, a lifeline is provided by her, her violin playing. She keeps her on song, on track. My older brother is a very different being to me. He became a Muslim. He has had a very different trajectory to his lifetime. We're now reconciled, which we weren't before, and I'm very glad that that is so. I've had a very rich family life. I owe a huge amount to both of my parents, even though I fought with them, definitely. I fought with my father quite strongly. He didn't want me to become a professional musician.
Mm.
He thought that was a terrible cop-out, that music should belong to the land. That's what he felt. My mother was wonderfully supportive and gave me the opportunity and the impulse, and above all the belief that I could do it, which she sustained right to her death, which I'm hugely grateful for. I'd been married 3 times. My first wife is still a very good friend, and we parted, I think, mostly because I would like to have had a family and she didn't want to. She did subsequently have children with another person. My second wife, Liz, is the mother of my 3 daughters, and she's a very strong and powerful personality who was a wonderful violinist and is a quite exceptional music therapist. And she led my orchestra for a while. But the things that made us separate in the end were to do with different lifestyle expectations. I think she would have preferred not to have been a conductor's wife. And when I was working in Lyon, head of the opera house there, the music opera house, it took me away just when the family was beginning to be born and to come into existence, and she would have liked me to have been around a lot more. And that caused a friction between us two. And my third wife, Isabella, is an exceptional person in every possible way. She's of musical pedigree. Her grandfather was the famous Victor de Sabata, a brilliantly distinguished Italian conductor who was artistic director of La Scala Milan after Toscanini. She has been a record producer, still is a record producer, and extremely good musician herself, and wonderfully supportive of my musical activities, but also loves the countryside in the same way that I do, and we have a very close bond, and she is wonderfully empathetic and in tune with my 3 daughters too, so that they get on very well together. So I feel very fortunate.
So that's a wonderful way to end. Thank you very much indeed, John Eliot.
You're very welcome.